I'm Davito Daveeni. Today we're going to conquer and explore Donetsk on a $20 a day budget.
The country of the Ukraine is located in Eastern Europe, between Belarus and Russia. And Donetsk lies in the southern eastern portion of the country, on the Kalmius River. This waterway links the city with the Sea of Azov, which is about 60 miles south. Under the Soviet rule back in 1924, the city was named Stalino. Its official name began in 1961. The biggest attraction is their ultra-modern, state-of-the-art, five-star football stadium. An industrial city known for its steel industry and coal mines, founded in 1869 by a Welsh businessman, John Hughes, who began the steel and coal industry. The current city population is just under 1 million. Starting from the city center, heading a few blocks north on foot, along the main artery of Artema Boulevard, we come across a park. And in the center is a tiny dollhouse chapel of St. Barbara. This small church was inaugurated on August 28, 1997, as a tribute to the memory of local coal miners who unfortunately perished in mining accidents. Heading two blocks south, then continuing east to the next busy street, we enter the gates to the exhibition center.
Here is the icon of Donetsk, Mertzlov's Palm. It was created out of a rail by a local artist in the 20th century. No welds or joints. He only used a hammer and chisel to produce this masterpiece.
The Palm won the grand prize at the Paris International Industrial Exhibition back in 1899. The original was donated to the St. Petersburg Mining Institute, while several copies are placed throughout Donetsk.
Behind me lies the city's most proud possession and attraction, the Donbass Arena. This impressive stadium was completed in 2009 at a cost of $400 million. It holds 52,000 seats.
Preceding the main entrance sits the world's largest floating granite football. The 28-ton ball is composed of many rocks that float on a thin layer of water. On the northern west side of the stadium, fountains add decor to pedestrians and passersby. The escalating roof design creates the effect of a flying saucer. The arena supports three restaurants, a lounge bar, cafe, fast food outlets, souvenir shops, and a fitness center. It can also host corporate events and concerts. The east side of the stadium connects to a wonderful park, complete with monuments and a museum.
Standing 30 meters high in the sky, and yet in Komsomol Park, is a monument dedicated to those who helped liberate the eastern portion of the Ukraine during World War II. Donbass Liberators Monument is the largest monument in the southeast of Ukraine.
It's the most important military history monument of the city and region. Also next to the monument is a collection of old military vehicles and artillery from that war period. These were placed here back in 2010 to honor the 65th anniversary of the success of the Great War. Below the great statue stands the memory wall with 275 names of heroes who were honored by the Soviet Union for their bravery in the war. They spent $30 million to renovate this well-groomed park, stretching from the stadium to the river. The memory bell weighs 860 kilograms, composed from leftover gun cartridge cases left in the battlefields. Underneath the Donbass Monument burns the eternal flame. Here also is the entrance to the War Museum, with various relics and military uniforms. Out in front, adjacent to the monument, is the Afghan War Memorial, dedicated to all those local soldiers who perished in the Afghanistan War. 36 plaques with 254 names encompass the site. The park continues east past the monument, ending before the riverbank. There's a rock fountain, children's playgrounds, a gazebo, flower beds including roses, benches, and manicured lawns spread out between the walking paths, with coal mines in the background. The Donbas Liberators Monument reaches 100 feet up and is seen throughout the park and surroundings. We return again to Artema Street. This is the main avenue running through the city center. A 20-foot statue of Artem towers over the avenue next to City Hall. It's a tribute to Fyodor Andreevich Sergeyev, nicknamed Artem, who was a Russian revolutionary, politician, and journalist, and good friend of Joseph Stalin. He died in 1921 at the age of 38. Just a few feet south of the statue is a replica of the Tsar Cannon, placed here in 2001. The original is in Russia, dating back from the 16th century. The symbol of the Russian state was a gift from the Soviets for the gratitude of receiving Mertsalov's palm. It weighs 44 tons, while each cannonball is at 265 pounds. Next to the cannon are the administrative offices in the City Hall building, with a handcrafted wrought iron rose statue, a symbol of Donetsk, and a concert of fountains in front. The original fountain dates back to 1966. It was removed and reconstructed in 2011. It consists of four pools. It is one of the most advanced fountains found in the Ukraine, with a beautiful evening water illumination display. On the southern side of City Hall sits another gift to the city. The steel Bochum Bell is a replica from the original German design that won a medal in Paris for its lightweight construction back in 1867. Walking west around the corner, right behind City Hall, is the most magical fairy tale place in Donetsk. This is the Forged Figures Park.
The Park of Forged Figures is located behind City Hall. Here you will find the fairy tale of characters and artistic designs created out of iron. On weekends, this place becomes the Park of Brides.
The park was created in 2001 when the city hosted the International Wrought Iron Festival. They decided to display the metal artworks in an area for all to see and enjoy. Since then, there has been an enormous addition of displays throughout the park. Each year, they replenish the park with new exhibits from the festival. Various metal sculptures include heroes of Ukrainian and foreign fairy tales, animals, flowers, zodiacs, forged arches, benches, and a whole bunch more. Entering from the back of City Hall on a winding path, we pass along metal characters and momentarily stop at a bridal party engaged in a photo session, a favorite spot for newlyweds. Feeling pretty small while standing in the royal chair, I continue walking past the lover's swing. Then come upon the Alley of the 11 Arches. The park is divided into several alleys with different themes dedicated to each one. The outdoor museum offers over 150 exhibits to wonder about and explore. The park setting would not be the same without these metal exhibits laid out along the paths and between the towering trees. Everyone seems to come here and try to figure out what the intent of each sculpture's design relates to. The metallic gardens seem to be very popular on weekends, with free admission and benches throughout the paths, a wonderful place to meet people or perhaps come and feed the pigeons. On the main entrance to the park located on University Street is the Ring of European Cities and is the main ring. This was a dedication to becoming a member of the International Ironworks back in 2008. The sacred iron gazebo holds many small locks from lovers who have pledged to secure their eternal love for each other. Donetsk is now officially recognized as one of the best blacksmith cities in the continent. Coming back out east on Vatutina Avenue, we stop at the corner of Artem Street and visit the Nicholas Vatutin Monument. He was a general and hero of the Soviet Army, helping to liberate the city from the Nazis on the Ukrainian front. Along the main city of Artem, there are cafes, bars, restaurants, and fast food vendors. This is an economical way for a quick bite to take out or eat there. With coffee and sandwiches, this place is very popular with students. Other fast food options are scattered throughout the city. on the corner of Artem Street and Modana Melnichkovo Avenue is the famous Liverpool Hotel, Dance Club, and Restaurant. This, a Beatles dedication with statues, signs, memorabilia, and music, happens to include one of the best food cafeterias in town with very affordable rates. There's a huge selection of local and international items with appetizers, soups, salads, fish, meats, and vegetables. A simple system without language problems. Just pick up a tray and point to an item you would like to add to your order. In the large dining area, there's also a refreshment bar and juice bar. With the appetizer, local soup, pierogi, main course, and drink, my total converted in dollars came out way less than my daily budget.
The Cathedral of Christ originally dates back to 1883, but they have recently rebuilt this church and made it much larger than the original. It was completed in 2006.
This church was destroyed in 1933 during an anti-religion campaign by the USSR. Construction began in 1997 to rebuild the church. In 2002, the capital city of Kiev presented Donetsk with a bronze statue of the Archangel Michael. Previously, this statue stood in Kiev's Independence Square. At present, the Archangel guards the entrance to God's holy temple. The interior is just as impressive as the outside. Unfortunately, when we filmed here, it was in renovation mode with scaffolds in the center. But I still found this to be exquisitely decorated with the religious icons, frescoes, and statues throughout the church. It can accommodate up to 3,000 people. The floor was artistically created with the finest ceramic tiles. The custom-made chandeliers brighten the room, while the windows create colorful wall patterns. The church is exquisite inside and out, one of the most beautiful structures in the city, towering above Central Square. Continuing our exploration from the church, we head back on Bodana Avenue going east, then a right on the next corner till we reach the Central Market. Central Market is simple to find as it's located on the backside of the church block. It's a large outdoor open market with stores, kiosks, and local flower and produce vendors that gather to sell their products. Here, locals gather to buy clothes, flowers, food products, hardware, and everything else. The aisles are filled with ice cream, pastry, and candy. There is fresh and dried fish, also imported canned goods, and eggs and local produce along the aisles. Besides clothes, you can find bargain souvenirs as well. Refreshments and local prepared foods are available if you get hungry shopping. In front of the main entrance, there's a tram stop if you get tired of walking around. Next, we head east from the market on Shevchenko Boulevard to reach the riverfront promenade along the Kalmius River embankment. The boulevard is lavishly decorated with various plants, trees, ornaments, and benches along the corridor. This walking park, with side alleys for cars along the boulevard, was named after a famous poet. We finally reach the river promenade, which happens to run south for about 1 1/3 mile. By day, this place is busy with joggers and strollers along the riverwalk, and by night, it's visited by lovers and newlyweds admiring the sunset or moonshine over the water. Some venture diving here for lost treasure, but I wouldn't recommend it, since the only thing you may discover is cold water. There are three historic bridges running over the 2.5-mile stretch of water. The Ilycha Avenue Bridge is typical Soviet architecture, designed for pedestrians and motor vehicle crossing. The promenade is filled with benches along the path, making this a favorite spot to relax and socialize. We now head back south along the riverwalk to return to the city center, admiring the sunset views along the way over the river's bridges. On Artemis Street, just a bit north on the opposite side of the famous church, stands a monument to the founder of the city. John Hughes put the city on the map with his development of the coal and steel industry back in 1869. Next door to the statue stands a monument dedicated to the students and teachers who tragically died during the period of World War II. Right next to the monument is the Church of St. Andrew. Dedicated to the patron saint of the country, this small church was opened in 2011. Walking along Artemis Street heading south are more monuments and historic places to explore. On the corner of Shevchenko Boulevard and Artemis is the famous poet statue of Taras Shevchenko. The monument sits in front of the Government State Administration Building, with the Krupskaya Library to its left side. It was made in Kiev and brought to Donetsk back in 1955. Besides a great poet, he is also remembered as a great fighter of oppression, slavery, and exploitation of the Ukrainian people. At the end of Shevchenko Boulevard, on the southern side of the street intersecting with Pushkin Boulevard, is the Regional Museum of Art.
Another great way to spend your time is to visit the Regional Museum of Art. This museum has over 11,000 pieces of paintings, graphics, sculptures, and includes decorative and applied art.
Since 1939, it has stored the richest collection of art, mostly from the 1700s to the 1800s. There's a small admission fee to enter the museum. At the end of the next corner, on Artemis Street, is Krupskaya Library. Constructed in 1956 with an extensive collection of historical books about the region. Artemis Street is a busy intersection with a constant flow of traffic passing through the center of town in all hours of the day. Down the block, further south on Artemis Street, is the Donetsk State Academic Opera and Ballet Theater, dating back from 1936. Alongside the entrance stands a golden monument, attracting the passersby.
Located next to Donetsk Opera and Ballet Theater, you can find this magnificent golden statue of Anatoly Solovyanenko. He was one of the best tenors.
Solovyanenko came from a mining family, and at 18 he began studying singing. His career finally started taking off at the age of 30. His operatic performances played in many countries around the globe. The memorial statue was erected in 2002, a few years after his death. The Donetsk State Academic Opera and Ballet Theater sits proudly on the main road with ongoing performances. Across the street on Titrania Avenue, just down the block from the Opera House, is another type of entertainment complex featuring a venue of dance clubs, bowling alleys, a casino, and movie theater. The Chicago Club Complex has been around since the late 1990s. Back on Artemis Street, on the next corner south of the Opera House, is another World War II memorial dedicated to Colonel Franz Grinkevich. Here, he lies in his tomb with his tank sitting on top. He was killed in 1943 and brought back by his comrades to be buried in this tomb. Next on the path is the General Gurov Monument. He was one of the hero leaders that helped liberate the country from the German Nazi occupation. He died at the age of 42 due to a heart attack in 1943. A bit further south on Artemis Street is the Academic Music and Drama Theater. It was constructed in 1961 and has five stages. Out in front of the building stands a modern sculpture by the famous Italian artist Lorenzo Quinn titled In Perspective, with part of the inscription reading, "The future is in our hands." Directly on the opposite side of the street is Lenin Square. It's the largest and most important square in the city. It was designed in the 1950s. Here they host all the city's celebrations, public events, and demonstrations.
The Lenin Square in Donetsk is a cool place to come hang out or meet people. It's located the smack center of the city and can be missed when you're in Donetsk. The traditional statue of Lenin is from the Soviet Union era and it still stands in its original place.
The highlight of the square is, of course, the huge Soviet statue of Lenin. Local residents from the city have buried letters under the flagstones of the monument to be discovered one day by future generations. But the memories of the Communist Party are not very popular with the younger generation, who mainly use the square for skateboarding. The statue was erected in 1967. Opposite the statue is a large fountain, and the building of the Ministry of Coal and the Post Office sit in the background overlooking the fountain. In 2003, they renovated the fountain to include lights and sound. At sunset, the fountain dazzles the spectators with the water show, choreographed to music playing in the background. Behind the Lenin statue is Prvominsky Park, the Lover's Gazebo, benches, and more statues to explore. This total area with the park and fountain on each side takes up 6.8 acres of prime real estate space in the center of the city. And during the winter, they install the city's main Christmas tree in this square. Returning to the other side of the road, then on the southern side street of the Drama Theater before Pushkin Boulevard, is the Goose and Swans Cafe. This is a traditional Russian cuisine gourmet restaurant with Ukrainian interior decor. The cozy dining area is two levels. There is also a large enclosed outdoor area used during the warmer season. They have an English menu with a large selection of local and Mediterranean dishes to choose from. All items are prepared and presented to look just as good as they taste. With the vast selection of items, it can be difficult to make a single selection. It's best to order a few appetizers to sample more of the flavorful dishes. My complete dinner with drinks, appetizers, and main course totaled up to $16.50, allowing me to stay within my daily meal budget. Walking back on Artemis Street, further south about 3/4 mile, I stopped to explore the Green Plaza Mall. It's located on the corner of Artemis and Sadovy Avenue, with a tall green-colored office building on top. Its construction began in 2007 and was completed in 2010, with 3 levels for the mall and 17 floors for the office complex above. The ground floor has a stylish cafe among the surrounding shops, and the ultra-modern shopping plaza also features a food court located on the 3rd floor of the complex. With a couple of food outlets, this is a great place to take a break or grab an inexpensive meal in the relaxing dining area. Now we exit the mall and continue on foot about 3/4 mile west to reach Donetsk's largest recreation area and park.
Park Shcherbakova was founded in 1932. It is the central and largest park here in Donetsk. It was completely reconstructed in 2006 and has 23 attractions, including a boathouse to rent boats and catamarans.
There are a few entrance paths into the park. There is no admission charge to get into the park. We proceed to enter the grounds through the Risha Avenue entrance, which continues over the pedestrian crossing bridge. During the old days, the bridge was used as the main entrance to get into the park. After reconstruction of the main entrance gates, it has become the secondary entrance way in. The 1,100-foot crossing takes us over the Misky Pond, which is less than a mile in length. Boat renters paddle along, feeding the floating ducks along the way. As I make the final approach to the entrance gate, I'm greeted by the Good Angel of Peace, placed on top of a long pillar. It was placed here in 2008 to honor the City and Miners' Day. Back in the old days, kids would collect their pennies to enjoy the small amount of rides in the park on weekends. After the reconstruction in 2000, all the old rides were replaced. Today, the number of rides and games has increased tenfold, with roller coasters, Ferris wheels, carousels, and jungle gyms. The park is named after Alexander Shcherbakova. He was the secretary of the Donetsk political party in 1938. It began with 296 acres of land, and later was increased, but decreased in 2000 to 237 acres of park. Its location is within the coastline of the connecting ponds. This is a paradise retreat for kids of all ages to come and play. Walking up near the front entrance, I stop by a very beautifully arranged flower bed. It's just one of many spots in the park where everyone stops to take a picture for a souvenir of their visit. Manicured walkways offer seating along the aisles, which are lined with chestnut trees, lime trees, and poplars, and include ornamental flowers and shrubs in the center and side gardens. Up from the north side of the bridge, behind the amusement park, is one of the best spots for taking pictures. This scene looks like a movie set from a Lost Paradise film. The composition was well designed to include a body of water surrounding the walkway passage. Over the past few years, the attendance to the park has tripled, reaching about 3 million visitors per season. Statues along the water bank have been replaced many times over the years. In the 1970s, they removed the Soviet statues that were placed here to display the greatness of the Soviet Union and remind everyone of its victories and achievements. The Blue Lion was a gift from another city in 2009. It represents the promise of friendship between Eastern and Western Ukraine. Occasionally, diesel locomotives pass along the east banks of the pond, breaking the sound of silence as they move along. Now coming back south along the water coast, at the end next to the main entrance gates, is an amazing array of the biggest rose garden I have ever seen. There's around 30,000 roses in different colors here. I would say this confirms Donetsk truly deserves its name as the City of Roses. Heading further towards the main entrance gates, I enter the main square. In the center rests a big decorative fountain. It's been here since 2007, when they started renovating the park. The main entrance wrought iron fancy gates are a new addition from 2008. It brings us out to Stadiona Street, where we will explore the neighboring sites. The Donetsk State Circus is directly across from the main entrance of Sherbakova Park. It was built in 1969 and opened for weekend performances, festivals, and celebrations.
There are a few shopping malls here in Donetsk. The Zolotoy Kolza Mall is one of the best. It has a nice selection of food courts at the top level, which offers various eateries to help you meet your culinary spending budget.
The Golden Ring Mall is situated in close proximity to the Circus and Sherbakova Park. It's a circular building with panoramic elevators and a variety of shops from jewelry to clothes on five levels. It opened to the public in 2003 with 120 retail outlets. The top floor of the mall features food courts serving local cuisine and international foods. Prepared foods are beautifully laid out for display, making it simple to quickly select from the array of dishes. The prices are much lower than most of the usual restaurants and cafes without any reduction of quality. With a spacious dining area, this is a great alternative for a quick meal without going over your spending budget. After the mall, we will continue walking just a few blocks east to reach our next destination along Sadovy Avenue. The new Donetsk Planetarium is a state-of-the-art facility which opened in 2008. Originally, the first planetarium dated back to 1962. Now one block north from here begins Pushkin Boulevard, a beautiful pedestrian park in the center of the boulevard, about 1 mile in length. At the beginning of the boulevard is a monument to four stratosphere Soviet pilots who died in 1938 when their balloon crashed on a high-voltage wire in Sherbakova Park. Here, artists display their works along the boulevard that are available for viewing or purchase to the passersby. This boulevard is very popular on weekends, especially on nice days when everyone comes out to stroll, socialize, and relax in the quiet park with the beautiful surrounding trees.
Pushkin Boulevard, it's pretty much a park in the very center of the city. About 1.5 kilometers long, it's a perfect place to stroll and admire the fancy sculptures, children playgrounds, cafes, sparkling fountains.
The Boulevard Park received its name from a great Russian poet, Alexander Pushkin. Creating this green boulevard started back in 1947 during Soviet times. It runs down on several long blocks immersed in greenery, and some parts include outdoor cafes and restaurants and bars. Continuing along the boulevard in the back of the drama theater is the beloved poet's monument to Alexander Pushkin, placed here in 1969. Each section has a unique style and pattern. Along the path are many interesting sculptures and monuments made by local artists, and also a few fountains, fancy flower beds, and decorative compositions. It's a fusion of Ukrainian and Russian cultures coming together. It is also a popular place for pictures and includes a children's playground section. As I'm walking along the boulevard on the section between the streets of Hirova and Tikhonya Avenue, I discover a fantastic monument dedicated to Donbas rivers, an ancient boat used on the calmest river in the old days when there were borders. Directly across the street from the sailing monument is a terrific place to stop for lunch. A franchise pizza place with beer and other delicacies at very affordable rates with quick service. You are able to order inside, then enjoy the outdoor views and breeze while it's being prepared. There's not much road noise here, since it's protected from the noise by the sheltering buildings surrounding it on each side. Up further north, before Mertslav's Palm, is a trail of elaborate modern sculptures created by the top Donetsk artist. At the end of the block is a lovely fountain with a replica of the Mertslav's Palm in the center of the walkway. The palm is the symbol of Donetsk. Shadowing the palm sculpture is the Donetsk State Regional Administration Building. This is the city's primary government headquarters and also the site where a number of pro-Russian protests were held. Entrance to Pushkin Boulevard is open all hours of the day. Besides its recreational usage, it also serves pedestrians as an alternate route for commuting within the city center. At the north end of the boulevard, after the government building, it continues a very short distance with an array of sparkling fountains and sitting areas until it finally ends at Bohdana Khmelnytskyovo Avenue. Donetsk, the city of roses, is a place built from hard labor, challenging times, and historic events.
I hope you've enjoyed this tour of Donetsk. Join us again next time as we conquer and explore more amazing destinations.